Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Eun-Seo Kang. I'm one of the associate pastors here at Wrightsville United Methodist Church. It is my great joy to welcome you to our worship service at the Vine on online campus of Wrightsville United Methodist Church. We are truly grateful to have this opportunity to worship together. No matter where you are joining us from, we cherish your presence with us today. So our prayer is, through today's worship service, you will experience a profound connection with God. So now, let us open our hearts and minds before God. Take a deep breath and feel closer to our Lord. Please join me in our opening congregational prayer. The words will be shown on your screen. Let us pray. Merciful God, search us and know us. In this season of Lent, grant us courage to take honest stock of ourselves and acknowledge our wrongdoings. Jesus, as we walk with you towards the cross, take away our bent to sinning and teach us how to live. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, I'm Pastor David Haley, one of your associate pastors, and I have the great privilege of leading us in our morning prayer today. Now, as I pray, I'm going to pause during the prayer to give you the opportunity to lift up the names of individuals that you especially want to remember in prayer today. And you can do that by speaking those names out loud where you are, or by speaking them in your heart. Okay. Let us pray. O God of unending goodness, we've come to this place, this day, to worship you with our songs, with our words, with our gifts, and with our whole hearts. We are reminded that our discipleship decision involves more than what we bring this day to the altar. Our discipleship calls us to a place where a cross that is ours alone must be picked up and carried. Lord, this more than anything else is why we need the community of your church. Strengthen us, we pray, not just to carry our own cross, but to help sisters and brothers carry their crosses as well. in the midst of this troubled world. We pray for peace, especially in troubled areas of the world, like in Israel and Gaza and the Ukraine. And we also pray for those near at hand who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. We especially pray for these whom we now name with our voices or in our hearts. Hear our prayers, O Lord, and sustain us in this hour. All this we pray in the name of Jesus, and as Jesus taught His disciples to pray and still teaches us today, so now we also pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We take a moment now to reflect upon our giving gifts back to God as an act of worship, as an act of investing in the kingdom of God. You can worship God by giving offerings at a live worship service or by mailing checks to the church at P.O. Box 748, Wrightsville Beach, North Carolina, or through our church website. So now it's time for the children's message. And if you've got children or youth nearby who aren't already watching the video, now's a great time to call them over. You might want to watch yourself because you might learn something you didn't know. Hey guys, I'm Pastor David, and it's my time to lead the children's message today. And we're thinking today about a story from the Bible about the Tower of Babel. This is a story that's found in the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis in chapter 11. And in this story, the people decided that they would build a tower that was so tall it went all the way to heaven. In fact, they thought they were so smart that they could do it without God that they didn't need God. They could build a tower without God's help. Well, God decided to show them that they couldn't do anything without God's help. Now, in that day, everyone spoke the same language. There was only one language spoken in the whole earth. And so they could easily communicate to build the tower. But God made them all to speak different languages. They could no longer communicate. They were not able to complete building the tower. Now, Pastor Doug and Pastor Insu and I are going to demonstrate what this might have been like and the problems that they face. So they're going to come help me.
Hey, y'all. I was wondering if y'all'd like to go get some lunch later.
No entiendo, pero tengo mucho hambre. Quiero dos pupusas de frijol y queso, pupusas con curtido y salsa, muy rico.
목사님, 아직 점심시간인 것 같은데 식사하셨어요? 김치찌개 드시러 가실래요?
I don't understand a word y'all are saying.
Grußgott, ich verstehe Sie nicht. Sprechen Sie Deutsch?
그러니까 지금 밥 먹어야 되는 시간인 것 같아. 식사 시간이요. 식사 시간. 배가 고파서 식사를 해야 하는 시간이요.
Can y'all not just speak English?
선데 먹기 본 très bien ensemble. Comment ça va? Très bien?
식사가 아닌 다른 건가요? 아니면 어디 식당을 우리가 가야 하는 걸까요? 어디서 만나면 될까요?
I'm thinking we might need to try this another time.
Ayo boen gorekande marhaval kifale mabsut bora dimenatsa che mai facets bine la revedere.
그러니까 거기 사거리에서 만나면 되는 거죠? 그럼 거기서 우리 만나는 걸로 해요.
Some other time. Bye, bye, y'all. Bye.
Bye.
Okay. Now, we were all speaking different languages, actually several different languages. We couldn't even make lunch plans, much less build a tower that went all the way to heaven. Now, how many languages did you hear? Four? Somebody's thinking six? Yeah, actually, it was eight different languages that we were speaking. Pastor Doug was speaking English. Yes, he was. And Pastor Insu was speaking in Korean, her native language. And I was speaking in six other languages, Spanish, German, French, Sinhala, Arabic, and Romanian. But we couldn't understand each other. See how easy it was for God to show them that they needed God to get to heaven. In their pride, they thought they could do anything, and they didn't need God. So when God made them to speak different languages, they were not able to complete their project, and they ended up scattering out across the earth. Now, we still need God today, and God helps us to do some wonderful things. Let's pray and tell God that we always need God to help us. Let's pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for the children and youth of our church and community and their families. We pray your blessings on them. Lord, help us to never forget that we always need you in our lives. And we're so thankful that you are always there for us and always there to help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, and grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Doug Lain. I'm senior pastor here at Wrightsville United Methodist Church, and it's great to be back with you this week. If you've been following with us over the last few weeks, you know that we've been in a series entitled, Who Am I? And we learned about what God had in store and what He intended for us from the very beginning. And now as we've moved into the season of Lent, we've looked at some ways that maybe we messed some of that up, and life got a little bit distorted, if you will, from what God originally intended. So we're still in the book of Genesis. We're in Genesis chapter 11 this week, and we're going to hear the story of the Tower of Babel. And it goes like this. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east, they came upon a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves. Otherwise we shall be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which mortals had built. And the Lord said, look, they're one people and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they'll do. Nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language there, so that they will not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. This is the word of God. For us, the people of God, thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy God, in the midst of our confusion here on earth, we ask that you will speak to us very plainly and directly, and Lord, that we might hear your word and live by it. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, my dad was a big American history buff. So a fun vacation for him was going to places like Colonial Williamsburg or historic Charleston, Philadelphia, Boston, you know, someplace like that to see the sights. But of course, the greatest collection of historical monuments can be found in Washington, D.C. So he and Mom would plan these trips to Washington so that my sister and I would learn to appreciate the history of our great country. We'd go to the National Archives, to Arlington Cemetery, to the Smithsonian Museum of Natural, Smithsonian Museum of American History. We'd go to the Natural History Museum too, for that matter. We visited the White House and the Capitol. But many of the most famous memorials are just out in the open on the National Mall at the center of the city. If you've been there, you know what I'm talking about, like the Washington Monument, Vietnam Veterans Memorial, or World War II Memorial. But for some reason, my favorite was always the Lincoln Memorial, that huge building with the giant statue of Lincoln looking out on the capital of the country that he reunited. Now, if you ever go visit the Lincoln Memorial, you'll see two speeches that he made inscribed on the walls beside him. On the south chamber, you'll see the words to the Gettysburg Address. And on the north chamber, you'll find the words that Lincoln spoke at his second inauguration. And when Lincoln delivered this speech, the country was still fighting the Civil War. And while it may have appeared obvious that the North would win, many Northerners did not want to let the Southerners back into the Union after 4 years of fighting against them. But Lincoln showed compassion for the Southerners, and with his famous words, "With malice towards none, charity for all," he helped quell the hostility among the Northerners. Now, those seven words certainly don't tell the whole story of Abraham Lincoln's thought toward the Confederate States reentering the Union. But the essence of his beliefs can be found inscribed on that wall. It's a fitting memorial. Somewhere on the other side of the planet, amid the shifting sands of the Middle East, stood another memorial. It stood for many, many years. It was not a memorial to a person, but rather one to a people. It was called a ziggurat. It was an unsightly pile of bricks, probably the home of rats and snakes. Perhaps as traveling merchants passed that way, one would look to the other and say, "Who left that pile of bricks over there?" And the other merchant would reply, "Well, according to the story I heard, it was once a huge tower that climbed all the way to the clouds." Evidently, the people who lived here a long time ago wanted to really make a name for themselves, so they built a tower, and that pile of rubble, well, that's all that's left of it. I think they called it the Tower of Babel or something like that. Well, let's come back to the present. Each of us is building some kind of structure with our lives. Your epitaph is being written even now. Is your life like a Tower of Babel, glorifying yourself? Or is it like a church spire pointing towards God? Are you just living a life, or are you leaving a legacy? I think the Holy Spirit wants us to ponder these questions today. Last week, Pastor and Sue preached to us about the story of Adam and Eve and the introduction of sin into the world. That was found in Genesis chapter 3. If you keep turning the pages of the Bible, you'll find the story of Cain and Abel in chapter 4, the genealogical list of very old people like Methuselah in chapter 5, and then Noah and the flood make up chapter 6 through 9. And when we get to chapter 10, we find the list of the descendants of Noah, and then we get to today's very interesting story in chapter 11. It's here in verse 4 that we find the people saying to one another, "Come, let us build a tower with its top in the heavens. Let's make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered." They wanted to be like God, or dare I say, maybe even replace God. They thought, "We can do this all by ourselves." Now, making a name for ourselves, is that really all that bad? Surely there is a place for legitimate ambition. If a young person wants to be the best heart surgeon or the most effective teacher or the most successful attorney in Wilmington, what's wrong with that? Nothing. As long as that's a secondary goal. But if one's central goal is self-promotion, then we begin to lose our soul. Arnold Glasgow in the Wall Street Journal said that if we had our way, most of us would choose the front of the bus, the back of the church, and the center of attention. Those ancient people who built the Tower of Babel, they wanted to be the center of attention. They wanted to enter heaven by their own power, and they wanted to make a name for themselves. We got a name for that. It's called pride, with a capital P, and that rhymes with T, and that stands for trouble. Right here in River City, to quote the Music Man, pride and ambition, they hinder unity. You see it in politics all the time. It seems to be more important for political parties to get their way instead of for the country to get its way. You could easily blame either side. Pride and ambition. But let's go back to what God intended for us. We learned last month that God created us to be in relationship with Him. Here, we're seeing the people trying to make themselves equal to God and trying to work apart from God. Which makes verse 5 really humorous, if you think about it. And the Lord came down to see this tower that the sons of men had built. Even after humanity had done its best to construct the biggest tower possible, God had to come down to look at it. Even our biggest feats are puny when measured up against the grandeur and power of God. Even the colors in Rome's Sistine Chapel cannot compare with the way God paints a sunset. Not even our harnessing of nuclear power can compare with the irresistible surge of the ocean's tides. All our creativity pales in comparison to the greatness of God. Then in verses 7 to 9, God scatters the people by giving them diverse languages, thereby causing confusion among them. They stopped building the tower. They took on the name Babel, which is Hebrew for a place of confusion. Selfishness and pride always produce confusion and chaos. Selfishness and pride break up marriages. They end business partnerships. They cause wars. The obvious question we must ask is this: are we building towers of Babel or spires pointing to God? I once read a story about a man who was married twice, first to Mary and then to Tilly. He outlived both of them. Finally, when he was getting quite up in age, he left these directions for his own burial. He said, "I want to be buried between Mary and Tilly, but tilt me towards Tilly." Our lives are going to tilt one way or another, usually towards self or towards God. Is the primary emphasis of your life self-promotion or God promotion? When your epitaph is written, would you rather say that you are president of your company or the spiritual leader of your home? Obviously, the two are not mutually exclusive. But which part of that epitaph gets your best thinking and energy? Which way are you tilting? Are you building a Tower of Babel or a spire pointing towards God? Some people spend most of their energy trying to become successful at work, to fulfill their own ego needs, to bring home a large paycheck. They assume that's all that's required of them. But a family deserves more than a paycheck and an occasional few minutes of leftover time. They need a servant, a spiritual leader who values the family more highly than the job. What about us here at church? I mean, literally, at Wrightsville United Methodist. Let's turn the focus on us for a minute. Did you know we're among the largest 1% of United Methodist churches in the entire country? It'd be very easy to get carried away with our bigness, the size of our membership and budget, the influence of our members throughout the Cape Fear region. Even a church can become a Tower of Babel if it gets carried away with self-promotion and institutional advancement. God forbid that we would become a kind of religious country club with lots of little perks for its members. I really doubt that God would be too impressed if we became the Microsoft of Methodism, the Walmart of the Wesleyan movement, or the Chevron of churches. The greatness of a church is its willingness to point beyond itself to Jesus Christ. God's more impressed when we're making disciples for the transformation of the world. So let's turn now in another direction and think of, I don't know, vacations. Well, suppose you plan to spend a week in the Caribbean with another family, swimming and snorkeling, eating great food, playing golf, boating, or baking in the sun. And during those days, you'll probably share thoughts about most everything. Tips on raising kids, what you've been watching on Netflix, the latest diet that really works, your best investment tips. But during all that time, does Jesus ever creep into your conversation? Any thanks for the trials and tribulations that he's helped you through? Will you give God glory other than the perfunctory nod at mealtime? The answers to these questions may reveal whether or not you're building a Tower of Babel or a spire pointing to God. How much of your life is sheer self-promotion? How much of it gives God glory? For in everything we do, God should be glorified. Back early one morning in the year 1900, there was a Swedish chemist you may have heard about. He went by the name of Alfred Nobel, and he was shocked to read his own obituary in the local newspaper. It said, "Alfred Nobel, the inventor of dynamite, who died yesterday. He devised a way for more people to be killed in war than ever before, and he died a very rich man." Actually, as it turned out, it was Alfred's older brother who had died. The reporter had bungled up the names. But that obituary had a profound effect on Alfred. He decided he wanted to be known for something other than providing a way to kill people efficiently and becoming rich. So he initiated the Nobel Prize, the award for scientists and writers who foster peace. Mr. Nobel said every person ought to have the chance to correct his epitaph in midstream and write a new one. I couldn't agree more. Do we need some epitaph corrections? Have we been doing some Babel building that we should forsake? Let's suppose that at your funeral, the preacher delivering the eulogy tells the absolute truth about you. Will she say that the central theme of your life was self-promotion or God-promotion? If you go to Waco, Texas, you'll find a great library at Baylor University. It's called the Browning Library. And it contains the greatest collection of the works of the poet Robert Browning in all the world. There was once a football player at Baylor who took a course under a professor who was passionate about the poetry of Robert Browning. He would wax eloquently on Browning, and his face would come alive and quiver with excitement. That football player only got a C in the course, but something about the professor's excitement about Browning lodged in this football player's heart. Well, the football player went out into the world and made a fortune in the oil business. In fact, he became a billionaire. And one day, he came back to Baylor and told the president that he intended to build a huge marble library on campus to honor Robert Browning. He sent employees all over the world to bring back every book and letter that Browning ever wrote. They even went to Venice and brought back the house where Browning lived and had it transported piece by piece to Waco, Texas. And on the day his great library was dedicated, the former football player, now an oil tycoon, escorted his old professor to a place of honor on stage. And he said to them, "Professor, your excitement caused me to get excited about learning. You always wanted a place where you could be surrounded with the things of Browning. Well, now you've got it." Well, just suppose that we became as excited about Jesus Christ as that old professor was about Robert Browning. What if the dominant passion of our lives were to know him and make him known? That passion would then become contagious. We could say with St. Paul, "For me to live is Christ." Then our lives would be like spires pointing heavenward, giving God all the glory. The question is, what are you and I building? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, you made us to be in relationship with you. But help us to remain humble, recognize that we are not the creator, but rather you have helped us, given us responsibility to be responsible for your creation. Our job is not to be like you, but to love you, to worship you, to give you honor and glory and praise. Lord, I pray that you will teach us how to be in relationship with you, how to love you and how to love others. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the question to wrestle with today is, what are we building? Are we building a life, or are we building a legacy? And with our lives, is it one that promotes us, or is it one that inspires others to look toward God? Well, of course, it's God who created us, redeemed us, and sustains us even to this day. May your life reflect God to the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.